Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church, and neither are we affiliated with any religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to showing proof of the existence of Yahweh our Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity into this present day. This school was established as a result of a divine vision and revelations given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. We were incorporated into the state of California in the year of 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and Canada and certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we teach by the true and correct names and title for the Father, the Word, our Son, and the Holy Spirit, as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true and correct name for the Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The name of the Holy Spirit, manifest in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been improperly substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lord's many and God's many. But we now know each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is the title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and correct name of our Father and His Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit. And in this state, he is inscrutable and incomprehensible and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of all things. We have Yahweh in his pure spirit state, symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Yahweh in pure spirit is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Just as you see, this fiery cloud has been drawn to extend all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart abides within this cloud. In like matter, everything in the creation and the sum total of the universe abides within this pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and form within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son. A super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. Later on, this self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walk the earth plain as Yahshua the Messiah, whom the world calls Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we must know that name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be had by reading the preface to the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him the tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We go forth in this school to show proof how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary constitutional aims and objectives of the Institute are as follows. First, is to help you find and know Yahweh Elohim as he really is and actually exists. Second, is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race or nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third, is to investigate the unexplained spirit law of the so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religion, psychology, philosophy, and modern practical and occult science. Fifth, is to extirpate current superstition, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth, is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh, is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. Eighth, is to earnestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. Ninth, is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning, ordained there is no other name given among men whereby a man can be saved, save in the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth, is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. We'll have a prayer this morning by Dr. Joe Williams, a scripture lesson on Romans, the 5th chapter, by Dr. Will Williams.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
All righteous Father, we'd like to thank you once again for allowing us to assemble ourselves here today to learn more of your divine purpose and your pattern, your plan of salvation. As we stand here humbly before you, Father, we ask that you give us a profound understanding of this great teaching that was dispensed on the day of Pentecost. We ask, O Father, that you anoint the speakers today and those that are in the school as they go forth, as they begin to grow and learn and understand this great teaching. We ask that you rent the veil of the flesh that lies in our heart and in our consciousness, and we can see us who we really are, and we understand who we are. So we can dispense this great teaching to those who walk around and sojourn on this earth. We ask you to bless us and to immerse us in the death, the burial, and the resurrection of the Yahshua Messiah. So he himself can become us, and we can see us who we really are and as we actually exist. We know, Father, that you and only you and you only deserve all the praise and all the glory and all the honor. We ask that you continue to strengthen this school and give us guidance and give us direction so we can go forth and preach the gospel of Yahshua Messiah to the entire universe. So that we all, Father, can see you as you really are and as you actually exist. Give us strength, give us guidance, and give us direction. We ask all these blessings in our only begotten Son, Yahshua Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Chapter, and I'll be reading to you from the Scofield Study Bible, which was edited by C.I. Scofield, published by the Oxford University Press of New York. And I'll be reading with the original names and titles imposed. Romans, the fifth chapter. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with Yahweh through our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand, and rejoice in hope of the glory of Yahweh. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience, and patience experience, and experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of Yahweh is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, who is given unto us. For when we were yet without strength, in due time, Yahshua died for the wicked. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet perhaps for a good man some would even dare to die. But Yahweh commendeth his love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, the Messiah died for us. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to Yahweh by the death of his Son, much more, being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And not only so, but we also joy in Yahweh through our Savior, Yahshua the Messiah, by whom we have now received the reconciliation. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for all have sinned. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come. But not as the offense, so also is the free gift. For if through the offense of one many are dead, much more the grace of Yahweh and the grace and the gift by grace, which is by one man, Yahshua the Messiah, hath abounded unto many. And not as if it was by one that sinned, so is the gift. For the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they who received abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Yahshua the Messiah. Therefore, as by the offense of one judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so by the righteousness of one the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. Moreover, the law entered, that the offense might abound. But where sin abounded, grace did much more abound. That as sin hath reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Yahshua the Messiah, our Savior. That was Romans the fifth chapter. Let us all say.
This Sunday, we will continue on with our winter series of lectures, and our speaker this morning will be Dr. Laurie Lawless. He will be speaking on the Adamic transgression.
Good morning, class.
Good morning. Good morning.
It's always an honor and a privilege to be able to testify to some of the things that Yahweh has revealed to me over the years. As the moderator said, that this is a school, not a church. So down here, research is required, rehearse. And what's the other one? rehearse. Yes, rehearse and research. The three R's. And so I'm going to try to do my best to kind of try to convey some of the things regarding the topic that I'm going to be discussing, which is the atonic transgression. Now, before we can even get to Adam, which was the creative son that Yahweh created from the very beginning, was on the sixth day, rather, put it that way. And that before we can get to Adam, we need to find out by what authority was given to write about him. Who was the writer, right? Mm-hmm. Who was the one that was given the information to write about him, you see? And so, like in the churches, we somehow, we kind of just glide over that. In fact, in most of the world, in the churches, what they do is they just skip the whole entire, what they call the Old Testament. They just skip the whole thing. And they say, well, we New Testament Christians, and we come out, the only volume out of the book we're coming from is from Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and then so forth and so on. But when you read about how God, I'll just use the terms in the world, how God created the man Adam, you see, from the dust of the earth, the first picture that came to my mind prior to coming into this class was that he created a man, right, with, and then somebody was back there witnessing to it, you know. But if we pick up John, I think it's 5:39, I think that's where you can find what the Messiah said about Moses, right, Nabil? He searched the scriptures, but then he goes on.
5:39,
let's pick that up.
Search the scriptures, for it is them ye think ye have eternal life. Mm-hmm. For in them ye think ye have eternal life. And they are they which testify of me. And ye will not come to me, that ye might have life. Mm-hmm. I receive not honor from men, but I know you, that ye receive not the love of Yahweh Elohim in you.
See, now he's saying, I know you don't have the love of Elohim in you. Mm-hmm. Continue.
I am come in my Father's name, and ye receive me not. If another shall come in his own name, him ye will receive.
Well, see, now we know, since being in this teaching, that his name is not a title like God or Lord. His name is Yahweh. But again, we need to have confirmation on that. So keep on reading.
How can ye believe, which ye receive honor one of another, mm-hmm. and seek not the honor that cometh from Yahweh Elohim only.
Continue, read.
Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. There is one that accuseth you, even Moses, in whom you trust.
Now see, he's saying, now there's one that accuses you. I'm not going to accuse you. There's one that accuses you even more. That's Moses, you see, in whom you trust. Because the scribes, the Pharisees, and all of they all respected and believed Moses, right? Because Moses was the lawgiver that really validate their existence as Jews, okay?
For had you believed...
Oh, I'm sorry, go ahead.
For had you believed Moses, you would have believed me.
It said, had you believed Moses, you would have believed me. Why?
For he wrote of me.
Because he wrote of me. Now we're getting somewhere, right? We're you know, like the more you dig into something, and it's like everything else, you know, the more research you do, the more answers you'll get, or information you'll get. And that's what separates us from churches. They don't do research. They go by whatever the minister tells them. And it's mostly a joyous occasion that deals with song, dancing, or whatever. But in order to really understand the relationship that man must have with the Creator, you got to know something about your Creator. It's just that simple. What is the scripture? You don't have to get it, but it says to be carnal-minded is death. Mm-hmm. To be spiritual-minded is life and peace.
Right.
See, now we've got these two staples here we're looking at, you know, and it represents a mystery that's been hidden for ages and generations, you see, but now has been made manifest, and that day happened on the day of Pentecost, you see. But now we're going to be obedient, we're going to do what the Messiah said to those non-believing Jews and go back to Moses, see. Now when we go back to Moses, now we're going to get to Adam, but there are certain steps you got to take before you can get back there to Adam, you know. Mm-hmm. And that is, we pick up Moses back here, and I'll kind of simplify it a little more. Moses was a Hebrew also, and we know that Abraham was like the first Hebrew that Yahweh talked to and made a promise to Abraham and told him that he was going to bless his seed.
That's
like
right.
The stars and, you know, in the heavens and the sand and the sea. But first that seed had to go down
yes.
In Egypt. See? Now we can pick up Moses, you see? Because Yahweh uses different vessels, you see, to carry out his will. And that's another thing I wasn't quite sure of also, but we're going to get to that in a minute. But here we got Moses down here. We know that he was raised up in Pharaoh's household by Pharaoh's sister, I think it was. And circumstances, when he grew up, circumstances was produced to cause Moses to come fleeing out of Egypt for his life, see. He ends up in the backside, he's in the wilderness of Sinai, and he's a tender of sheep, you see. His father-in-law, Jethro, was the priest of Midian back here. And so Moses is content at this point because he feels that he has escaped the death that was going to surely visit him back here. And now Yahweh is ready to work with him. So he appears to him in a burning bush, you see, and he in the backside of Mount Sinai. And then here's Moses, you see, saying, now I'm going to turn aside and see what this great sight is, you see. This is a bush, burning but not being consumed. Now that is a phenomenal sight, see. And Yahweh, see, now Yahweh's going to work with him and let him know that he made a promise to Abraham, and now he's ready to make good on that promise. But first, Moses, you're going to have to go down in Egypt and deliver the children of Israel out of there and bring them back to worship me, you see, which is what he ended up doing eventually. And Moses was making up excuses, and he finally, you know, surrendered and went on back down there in Egypt, you see. And 10 devastating plagues was poured out before he let him go, but eventually he did. Through the parting waters of the Red Sea all the way through here to the wilderness of Sinai, where Yahweh calls him up in a mountain and told him to, excuse me, told Moses that had the children of Israel clean up because he was going to speak to them against the third day. And the Israelites, see, they cleaned up, they gathered around the mountain, so not to touch it or anything, but just to gather around it. And Moses and Yahweh spoke that law from the mountain, and they, you know, they went through all kinds of different changes. Moses' second trip was based upon Yahweh instructing him to draw tables of stones, the coming and receive the tables of stones that he's going to give him. That was going to be written with the finger of Elohim. And so Moses goes up here into the second trip in the mountain, and this is where he sees Moses. And so Moses is in the cloud, you see, where Yahweh is allowing him to, he's revealing himself to Moses in a shape and form. Now, this cloud that you see here that the moderator told you about is symbolic of Yahweh in this abstract shape and form. With these nine divine attributes, intelligence, wisdom, knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, and strength, these attributes all take on shape and form in the shape of a man or a super incorporeal anthropomorphic being. Moses now sees the image of Elohim, shape and form, and with the book, with all of the names of those of the Book of Life was in that book.
That's right.
Now here he is transforming to a threefold pattern, tabernacle pattern here. You see, and Moses is seeing this, plus there are 70 elders, 70 elders and Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu, they're all seeing this image, you see, that transpired right here in front of their eyes. See, and then that image goes on to take this shape and form of this tabernacle pattern here, and then back into this same supercorporeal form, and then into each consecutive day, which is 7 days, including the seventh day, the man on the sixth day, and the seventh day of rest. Mm-hmm. Now, Moses is seeing Adam and Eve in the garden, you see. Now this is how we pick up Adam and Eve, you see, it's in a vision. So when we read Genesis, the first, second, third chapter, and so forth, we understand that there is a prophetic timetable set up that's being shown to Moses in a vision, so he can understand how the man came into existence on the sixth day, mm-hmm. you see, and how Yahweh allowed for that man, that same man, to be. Now he created him outside of the garden. He created him from the dust of the earth, right? Breathed the breath of life in him. He placed him into the garden, mm-hmm. puts him to sleep again. See, this time he takes the woman out. You see. After he takes the woman out, here she is in the garden with him, and I need that plate 12, and if I can get also 13, 14, and 15. See, now we understand what Yahshua was telling those scribes and Pharisees back there. He's saying, well, now, actually, you put it right next to the door. Yeah. See, when Yahshua was told those scribes, Pharisees, saying, "Well, Moses wrote of me." See, now we got some type of a validation on that. You see, because we see now that when Moses was called up there in that cloud, the second trip. It was also Joshua, his minister, went up there with him, and it was Joshua was the one that transfigured, you see, into this threefold super image, incorporeal image of Elohim, you see. And these 74 people witnessed to that, see. How do I know that? How do I know that they saw Joshua transfigured? Because in the fulfillment, I'll just put it over here like this. Because in the fulfillment, you have Peter, James, and John, just like Aaron did that revival, and the 70 elders, they're witnessing to Joshua in fulfillment transfigured before them. So naturally, they had to see him transfigured before him here. Right. See, it's a confirmation mm-hmm. on both ends of the bookends, I'll put it that way.
Really?
Let me see. Okay, so now we're getting there. Just a little patient there. We're trying to get to Adam here. Now, we also know that on that after that second trip that Moses came down, you know that there was he was called out of the mountain because he watched the 7 day creation come in existence. He also watched Yahweh built that the instructions and the functioning of the tabernacle the remaining 33 days. He was called out of the mountain, and there was a ruckus in the camp. See, because these 74 people here left. But Moses went up there and stayed for so long, Moses told them to stay there while he go up in the mountain, and which they did for a while, and then they said, look, he's not coming back. It's been nearly, it's been weeks now, he hasn't been back, so let's leave. Let's get into some party, y'all. You know, they build a golden calf, and they were partying all day and all night doing their thing, see? Now, here's Moses coming out of the mountain, you see, after that second trip, and he waxed hot when he saw this, you see? Mainly because when he left Adam and Eve in the garden, they were in perfect harmony, see? Like right here,
right.
Sitting on that rock is like a symbol of stability. Mm-hmm. And he's sitting there, they're just, as Will used to say, they're just in love as they can be. Peace and harmony. You see what I'm saying? Now, here we go again. Now Moses, and he didn't understand that when he broke those tables of stone, but when he was called back up to the third trip, remember Moses, Yahweh told him, said, okay, now you hew out two more tables, you know, bring them up, and I'm going to write again on them, okay? And this time, you see, you're going to place them in the same place where the first ones were carved out of, you see? And so now Moses is made to understand. See, when he's called back up this time, he's shown another recapitulation of the seventh-day creation. Now Yahweh shows him a little something different. See, now Yahweh is showing him how that bad boy creeped in. Now, he didn't really creep in. You know what? He was allowed to step in. Just like he was allowed to step foot in that particular territory where he was, where he deceived the third of the angels, Yahweh just allowed him to come on down. And look at this, folks. See right here?
Yep.
See, now we're talking about here on that third trip. Now, you're looking at Lucifer and his angels being cast out of heaven. Now, here's the unfinished earth down here. Okay? And this is what Moses is looking at. He's looking at, in that third trip, he's looking at how that bad boy was allowed to step in. Because see, once that earth was finished, after he created the man on the sixth day, put it over here a little bit so you can see it. See, on that sixth day, see, now the earth is finished. Now he and his boys can come in, see. And they now, and as one body, you got that angel coming in there. And he's allowed, you see, to deceive the woman, see? Now, we know that this is where most Christians are just, carnal-minded people, they'll start here. They say, well, in the beginning, Yahweh created the heavens and the earth, and then Adam and Eve on the sixth day, and then they leave it alone after that, mm-hmm. But it wasn't until coming into this teaching that you find out, no, this is just the beginning, Because the beginning starts here in Exodus, you see, with Moses coming out of Egypt with the Israelites and everything, and then being shown how Yahweh drew him into this cloud and showed him the six-day creation, seven-day rest, you see. And then the man on the sixth day, you see. Now, and then Yahweh puts the man back to sleep again, takes the woman out after they placed him in the garden, right? And now we have Yahweh, you see, now he allows Lucifer to come in and deceive the woman, okay? He couldn't deceive the man. See, remember, Yahweh breathed the breath of life in the man, and he became a living soul.
That's right.
See, but at the same time, that woman was in the man, too. Mm-hmm. But he allowed the woman to be deceived, He made the woman subject to vanity.
Right.
See, so therefore, if anybody was going to drop, it was going to be her. Adam, you see, also partook of the fruit, but it was not by deception. See, the whole transgression was based upon deception. Mm-hmm. The man couldn't be deceived. He didn't even try, you know, because that's the way Yahweh set it up. So here's the woman being deceived. She protects the fruit and then she gives it to her husband and he then eats, you see. Now they're coming out of that garden. See that? Now, that was the first sin, right? We come over here. It says age of conscience. See, we just spoke to you about the angelic creation and the physical creation that involved both the angel and Adam and Eve creation in the earth plane with Adam and Eve. You see, these little lines here shows forth a interrelationship between that which is spirit and that which is physical. Okay, the angelic creation and the physical creation. That closed out and then opened up the Adamic covenant and the Noahic covenant. Now, in the age of conscience, this is the antediluvian age, the age before the flood, right? Now, here we have, in Adam, it says, in Adam all died. Someone get for me Genesis 3, 6, Romans 6, 12. Yeah, Genesis 3, 6. Get me Romans 5. Pick up at 11 instead.
Genesis 3 and 6. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and the mm-hmm. tree to be desired to make one wise, mm-hmm. she took of the fruit thereof and did eat. And gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat.
We already went over that, right? Continue reading.
And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together, and made themselves aprons. Mm-hmm. And they heard the voice of Yahweh Elohim walking in the garden in the cool of the day. Mm-hmm. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of Yahweh Elohim amongst the trees of the garden. And Yahweh Elohim called unto Adam and said unto him, Where art thou? And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid, because I was naked, and I hid myself. And he said, Who told thee that thou wast naked? Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee that thou shouldest not eat? And the man said, The woman whom thou gavest to be with me, she gave me of the tree, and I did eat.
Okay, now pick up Romans 6, 23. We'll start off at 23.
23? Mm-hmm. For the wages of sin is death, mm-hmm. but the gift of Yahweh is eternal life through Yahshua Messiah.
See, now this is what we got, folks. See, now the wages of sin is death, right? Mm-hmm. And death reigned from Adam all the way to, and we'll get it right here too, from Adam all the way to the cross of the Messiah.
That's right.
But and even though in the book it says to Moses, mm-hmm. what we're talking about is the Moses dispensation, which lasted for 377 years at the approximate time when the Messiah himself was coming in on, according to the prophetic timetable, spiritual timetable, here on the fourth day. Mm-hmm. You see, that's what we use down here, folks. We use calculated prophecy that's already in our Bibles, you see, to help us to gauge where we are at any given time, you see. Now, if the wages of death was sin, which is what they did, they sinned in the garden, see, there were extenuating circumstances involved, because to be honest with you, Adam, he willfully died for his bride. So he was being, how did we say it, he was being obedient to be disobedient.
That's right.
You see, he had to partake of that fruit after his wife, after Eve ate it, and she's like coming. Now, who was that? Was it Will or Joe? Was showing how Eve was coming with the fruit. You know, she was saying, "Here, take it. It's not bad." And he knew right then. You see, but keep in mind, folks, this is Yahweh's show. He is the one that is wearing all the hats. You okay?
I think if we keep that in mind, we can kind of understand. Because before, I was saying, wow, this is a weak creator, a creation. The man, Adam, is weak. You know, that's the first thing you come to your mind by not knowing what's really going on in there, you know. But it went exactly according to Yahweh's plan, purpose and plan. And so now we got the death thing coming all the way down here. And here's the Abrahamic promise, see, that's going on. And then we have under the Old Testament, with the Mosaic law. And see, here is where that law comes to an end. Get for me Hebrews 9 and 26 and 1 Corinthians 10 and 11.
Hebrews 9.
Oh, wait a minute. Oh, could you just hold those two? Hold those two. I want somebody to get for me 1 Corinthians 15 and instead of 22, let's pick it up at 18 first.
1 Corinthians 15 and 28.
I mean, 1 Corinthians 15 and 18.
1 Corinthians 15 and 18. Then they also which are fallen asleep in the Messiah are perished. If in this life only we have hope in the Messiah, we are of all men most miserable. Mm-hmm. But now is Yahshua risen from the dead and become the first fruits of them that slept. Mm-hmm. For since by man came death,
yeah,
by man came also the resurrection of the dead.
Okay, hold on, hold your point right there. Just ease on over here right quick. Give them back these charts here. Okay, read that one more time.
But now is the Messiah risen from the dead,
okay,
and become the first fruits of them that slept.
See, the first fruit of those that slept, go ahead.
For since by man came death.
Well, by man, talking about Adam, came what?
Death.
Right? Okay, go ahead.
By man came also the resurrection of the dead.
See, here's your two Adams right here we're talking about. By this man came death. By this one, we're talking about the created son and the only begotten son, mm-hmm, or the two Adams. See, by one man came death, you see, and read it one more time.
For as in Adam all die,
even
so in the Messiah shall all be made alive.
Even in the Messiah shall all be made alive. Now look what's happening, folks. And now as the Messiah risen from the dead, the first fruit of those that slept on the face of the earth, he's going all the way back there and he picked up Adam, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because he was the first, he was a type or a figure of the Messiah. See? So when Adam died, all died. Why? Because it had to validate this one here. When he rise, everybody gonna, you see what I'm saying? Everybody gonna be part of that glorious day, you see, when he rises from the tomb. Why? Because now he is that rock that was hewed out of that stone, you see, and smoked his image. Because as long as death reigned from this one to this one, you're gonna see this picture here. See? This image shows all the kingdoms of the earth that, well, as far as Yahweh is concerned, that took place after this particular event here. And you can see how that serpent with that crown on his head, he's reigning or he's ruling. That's what that means. And he's coming on down to ages and dispensation just like the Israelites did. Just like Adam did. And when he did his 930 years, he gave up the ghost, as they said, and then Yahweh just went on and started picking, you know, Noah. Here's the elementary chart. This is the way it's played out. See, after the Adamic transgression and everything.
Same thing. Yeah. Same plate. Yes.
Oh, it's the same thing.
It's 15 on top of 15.
Oh.
So you ain't got to move it.
Okay.
It's a big 15.
Yeah. How's that?
Yeah.
Okay. And then here we go. You know, we're talking about time traveling. Because that's what the Messiah, that's what Yahweh, he's a time traveler in his own time. You see? And what he's doing is he's showing us how, throughout the dispensation of time, how he has got into a man. Or what was that scripture that says, holy men of Yahweh,
spake
as they were moved by the Holy Spirit? See? That's him. When you read about Noah, you see, and how he was commissioned to build an ark and to preach the gospel to the four corners of the earth. Well, all these things you will soon find out is going by a pattern, because right here, is what Moses was commissioned to build in the wilderness when he came out of that wilderness. He was told to build one just like he did in the mountain. I think it was about, what, 7 different chapters dedicated to the details and specifics of that pattern. And this is the results of that. See, we're looking at a 3-fold pattern that has 9 basic furnishings in it. You see, and these furnishings, the Ark of the Covenant, you know, see with the 2 archangels and the mercy. This was made of gold, beaten gold, and then you had the altar of incense. You had the table of shewbread and the 7 branch candlestick. See, now these were furnishings of gold. These here were the brass, brazen laver, the brazen altar of sin sacrifice. These were made out of brass, you see. Now, we showed you how that death reigned. Now, that's symbolic by this altar of sin sacrifice here, how from Adam, death reigned from Adam to the Messiah. Well, when Yahweh had Moses to put that pattern in existence, the operation of this pattern was basically the same way. It had a priesthood, which function is going on in there. It was also sacrifices. Romans 6 and 23. Might be 6 and 23.
6 and 23.
Yeah.
For the wages of sin is death. But the gift of Yahweh is
eternal. Oh, that's right. You read that one.
Yeah, we read that one.
Okay. There was one I wanted.
Hebrews.
Let me see. I might have it here.
9:6.
But now. Okay. Yeah. That's the one I wanted.
Hebrews 9:6. Mm-hmm. But now he hath obtained a more excellent ministry, by how much also he is the mediator of a better covenant, which was established upon better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, then should no place have been sought for the second.
Okay. Which is true, right? I mean, you know, if they could have kept that first law back there, there would be no need for him to come in and fulfill it. Plus, then it would also try to make him out of a liar. Because why? Because if death reigned from Adam all the way to the cross of to the Messiah, and then you're telling me that the wages of sin is death, you know, then everybody would have said, well, okay, we can keep that law now, so you won't have to go into, you know, that kind of a dimension of things, you know. But the fact that no one could keep that law, and so when the Messiah did come in on the 4,000th time, we see him, see, nailing that to the cross. All we're talking about cardinal ordinances, circumcision, ceremonies, baptism, Passover, sacrifices, 10 commandment laws, all nailed to the cross. He came in the likeness of sinful flesh, see, to fulfill that which was in the flesh, okay, in order to usher in the age of grace of the Holy Spirit. See, Jeremiah 31, 31.
Jeremiah 31:31. The day has come, saith Yahweh. Behold, the day has come, saith Yahweh, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them.
You see, I was a husband to them, but what happened, you know? They just went buck wild, you know. I mean, I'm talking about from the time they were drawn out of Egypt until the time of the destiny, which none of them made it. I mean, every last one of them that came out of Egypt died off in that wilderness,
right,
except for the offspring. Now, what that is, it is spiritual. That is a physical perception that validates a spiritual reality. What I mean about that, if all physical bodies died off in the wilderness, right, then we know that their offsprings, and these were from the tribe of Benjamin. I think you were telling me, Joe, how the offspring were all men of war at that particular time. But at any rate, that all of those that came out of Egypt died off in the wilderness. Mm-hmm. And so those that came out of Egypt did cross over in the leadership of Joshua.
That's right.
And that shows a significance of how this old law here that they were under that came out of Egypt, how this old law, it died right here on that cross. And how he ushered in, you see, that new birth or offspring, you see. So here it is on the day of Pentecost. Here's the Jews right here, man. They all caught in one room, and they received the Holy Spirit, you see. The Holy Spirit, and then 7 years later, the Gentiles. So Jeremiah 31, he kept his promise. He said that he was going to write a new law in their hearts and minds. And that's what this big heart symbolizes, you see. Kingdom of Yahshua, spiritual sacrifices, law of the Spirit. Galatians 6 and 8 and Romans 8 and 2. Okay? Because now here you see from Adam and Eve coming out the garden to Noah's Ark, to the Tower of Babel, the Abrahamic promise, and then from the law being spoken down from the mountain. Covered a lot of ground, you see. From the fall of the first man, Adam, all the way into this age now. See, now, go ahead, read.
Galatians 6 and 8. For he that soweth to his flesh shall of the flesh reap corruption. But he that soweth to the Spirit shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting.
See, now, that's just the same thing we started off with. We were showing you to be carnal mind is death, to be spiritual mind is life and peace. That's just an example showing you. See the corruption in man. You know, we were talking about the egotistical, misdirected personality, the EMP, you see. Well, see, in this age, we should be able to detect all of that
right now,
you see. Mm-hmm. From any speakers coming from the floor to voices you may hear in your head, you know. Oh, wait a minute, that ain't right. Something ain't right here, you know. I mean, this is the war we're going on with now. See, we're discerning. We're casting aside those things that do mind the flesh, mm-hmm. you see. And so what we have to do in this age, you see, is realize, you see, becoming conscious of the fact that we no longer have to offer up these things and do these things. Now, I don't know if they're still doing them in the churches. The baptism and all that stuff.
They're still doing it.
Right?
Yeah.
See, they still, because they still believe that it is a tangible thing that must be done in order to accomplish, you know, the rite of passage, so to speak. But the rite of passage is through him, mm-hmm. you see. No man goes to the Father except he that comes by me, you see. And that's exactly what he did, because when he was nailed on that cross. I mean, in fact, he would not let anyone touch him until it was time. Because they got ready to grab him one time, man, and he just poof, just disappeared. Where did he go? You know? But, you know, it just goes to show you who's running the show, you see. Mm-hmm. And so here we are. I get one more scripture. I'm going to kind of close it out with this, and I'm going to sit down. And I wrote it down because I knew I was going to get it. Give me, it's in the volume, it's in the text. Go with volume 1, page. Wait a minute. Come on, let me see. 567. Volume 1, page 67, drop down to the last paragraph, I think.
The migratory pattern, the threefold pattern.
Oh, that's volume 1? Yeah. Volume 1, page 67.
What do you want?
I want where the woman...
Division between male and female?
That's what I want.
That's the bottom of page 66.
Oh, 66, I'm sorry, okay, 66.
Adam being created in the image of Elohim, possessed both masculine and feminine hormones within himself.
Okay. Adam being both male and female, possessing both hormones within himself. Proof of that is the woman was drawn out of the man, right? and then right here we can see how the woman was drawn out. Now continue to read.
a figure of Elohim that gave birth to or created the universe.
See, now this is the same, this is a figure, talking about when Adam and Eve is a type or a figure of him that gave birth to the universe. Now we're talking about Yahweh Elohim, see? Mm-hmm. So, and that's also Yahshua the Messiah. But here he is, being both male and female within himself, you see, didn't have to go outside of himself to bring birth to a creation, the cosmos, and everything in it, you see. This one is a figure of him, is what they're saying. Continue to read.
As shown in plate 12e, Elohim caused a deep sleep to fall upon Adam, a figure of death and burial, or spiritual immersion, and took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh instead thereof.
Now, I don't know, can you zoom in on that? Right here is an incision in Adam. Can you see that? It's gonna be kind of hard to see, because I can hardly see it myself. But it says incision. Here's Adam laid out here, and here's an incision, and then this is where he was pierced in the side. Okay, continue to read.
The deep sleep falling upon first Adam, the taking of the rib from his side and formation of the woman, and her presentation to him was a figure of the soldier piercing Yahshua in the side.
Okay, you see that? How this piercing here on the side is a figure of the soldier that pierced Yahshua in the side, you see? I'm talking about how things are just systematically laid out, perpetually and methodically laid out for us. The whole universe, you see, all reality is under that one single principle, a threefold principle that started right here. Actually, it was in the cloud. All that was in the cloud, and this was brought forth. Just like down here, the Spirit moved on the face of the water, you know, like Yahweh is the heights, the depths, the breadth, the length, the heights, the depths, right? The oceans, the lakes, the valleys, the streams, the canals, the whole nine, you see? So that's why Eya Asher Eya is very necessary, because we don't want to just limit him to, you know, one image here without seeing the rest of him, you see? And that's what he has shown us. Continue to read.
The deep sleep, or after his death and resurrection, mm-hmm. the presentation of the woman to him.
Now check this out, this is important. Go ahead.
Was fulfilled by the saints that slept in the dust of the earth and rose and went into the holy city.
See, now see that? You see, here the veil shows division of the sexes. Now that's the woman being, after she was taken out, you know, they're walking around, hanging, as they say in the garden. And then, then it says what? Yahweh presented the woman to the man. Is that what it said?
Mm-hmm. The presentation of the woman to him.
Okay, now the presentation of the woman to the man, Adam, is reflective or I'm sorry, just finish reading.
Was fulfilled by the saints that slept in the dust of the earth.
See, and here it is. You see this? You got that, Ethan?
Mm-hmm.
See how these, see, this is the bride too. Those that slept in the face of the earth, see, he's the first fruit that raised from the dead, right? And then, remember, and then all of those that slept in the face of the earth, they came forth and marched on into Jerusalem. Now that's symbolic. See, you see how both operations, you see, are validating the same principle, you see? His bride has been restored back unto him. And right here, what do you see? You see that woman clothed in the sun. That's the validation as well, you see? Showing how that woman's clothed in the sun, see, is a validation that she, on the day of Pentecost, she was put back in the man. Because back here, remember, they were showing how the woman was taken out, see? And Yahweh presented the woman. Now, that was one of those little quick minute that took place. But what it does is it says a whole lot about the whole mystery itself. Because when that woman was drawn out and was allowed to be drawn into darkness, then Yahweh saw it necessary at a prophetic time period in the proper amount of time to restore that woman back unto the man. And that's the beauty behind this mystery, the transgression, is that it shows forth a death that rained all the way to the Messiah, but he had it covered all this time, you know? It's nothing to worry. When he said, hey, you know, don't worry about a thing, that kind of thing. Now I take comfort in that because it was a time, man, where...
Go ahead. Go ahead, boss.
It was a time. And I didn't think I was going to make it, man, I'm telling you. And I just asked, you know, just keep me hanging in there, y'all, because I know I'm not as strong as I could be, I want to be, but it's a beautiful thing, man, when you can come down here and y'all would reveal things to you. I value that very much, and I just want to make sure that I'm found doing something, you know what I mean? My biggest strength is just the drawings and the paintings.
Okay.
And I tell y'all, just keep me into that, doing something for you. Because a lot of people, man, are lost and don't know it. And every last one of us have made a testimony to that in terms of our family, you know? But I think if you hang around here long enough, you're going to realize that everything's going to be all right, you know? You just got to be obedient. That's the bottom line, man. You just got to be obedient and just come to class. And I don't care how bad you're feeling, man. I'm telling you, man, I got so many aches and pains and stuff, man. And I'm taking 12 different medications and stuff, man. And it's just, it's a struggle. But you know what? It could be a whole lot worse. And with those words, I thank you.
Our next speaker this afternoon would be the dean of the school, Dr. Joe Williams.
Those two plates on the end down there. Plate number number 1 and 2. I enjoyed the previous testimony. Put it right here. What we're talking about is the Adamic transgression. And really and truly, if we just got this plate understood, the entire purpose and plan of Yahweh is just very simple and very easy because it's always talking about you. The thing about Lloyd, he didn't tell it all, but what he left the class for a while. You know, when he left the class, you know, he got caught up in the world, just really daily stuff, because, you know, see, the thing about the adversary, what he does, he takes our mind off Yahweh. He have us caught up in our job, in politics,
right,
and family matters, family squabbles, little simple petty stuff. You know, your wife, your girlfriend, your friends, your partners, you know. It can be, I gotta go to the doctor today and I gotta wait for 2 hours to get one simple test. Our minds get focused on everything but Yahweh. That is his job, and that is his duty. And when I say this is his duty, I'm talking about this is the adversary. That is Lucifer's duty to keep you in darkness. All right? Now, when Yahweh called Moses up in the mount, you see, he called Moses up in the mount. This plate here is the same thing as this chart. You see? It's plate 13, but it's talking about the migratory pattern of the children of Israel coming up out of the land of Egypt through the dividing wall of the Red Sea and into the wilderness. This is the mountain right here, but I'm just going to point to the big mountain over here. Because see, when he gets up in this mountain, Moses has no idea when he goes up into this mountain that he is going to see what he saw. I'm just going to slide this down just a little bit. And what Moses saw was a rerun or recapitulation of the creation, how it came in by the pattern. We really need them all. Let's do that. Let's just do that. Maybe not. We'll just do it this way. I think I can do it this way. In other words, he saw how the creation came in by the pattern. But when Moses is in this mountain here, he is blacked out. Meaning what? He is not conscious of his physical body. He is not conscious of that mountain. Only thing that he is conscious of is his very essence. His essence is divine intelligence, wisdom and knowledge, beauty, love, justice, foundation, power, strength. In other words, these attributes is what he was become, what he was conscious of. And Yahweh took the very essence that he is, which are the attributes, which are the basic fundamental principle of mankind. And Yahweh dealt with that was in Moses, you see, which was a manifestation of the Holy Spirit in Moses. And Yahweh caught him up, you see, and showed him how the creation came in by the pattern of himself. In other words, Yahweh Elohim himself, he is the pattern. Okay? And listen, when Moses saw it, it was in minute detail. Textbook, page 50, volume 1. I want the second paragraph because I want to move and get up on out of here. Where it says Elohim. See, we already talked about how the Yahweh is spirit. You see, Yahweh being the ultimate source, the substance, the limits, the bounds, and the origin, and the essence of all things. You see, it is in Yahweh that we all live and we move and we have our beings in him. There is nothing that is outside of Yahweh or anything that pre-existent of Yahweh. Yahweh himself is the only independent self-existing deity. There is none other. And everything that you see and that you don't see that is known and unknown is one of another expression or a manifestation of Yahweh himself. Yahweh is spirit, you see. And listen, these attributes took on a shape and form as Yahweh Elohim, you see. But prior to that, these attributes, you see, in reality, Elohim is no more than an organized set of attributes. In other words, he is a spirit embodiment, if you will. You see, that's what he is. And these attributes is no more than the creation made manifest, if that makes any sense. In other words, Will says this all the time. He says, your nervous system, you see, points to intelligence. In other words, your nervous system is a manifestation of intelligence. You follow me? Your respiratory system is a manifestation of beauty. So it's a manifestation of the true attribute which Yahweh really truly is, to let you know that you are what you've been looking for. Now we're talking about the Adamic transgression. Alright? So we're showing how Yahweh is calling Moses up in his mountain and showing him a rerun or the origin of how mankind came into existence. Plate 11 needs to go right here, please. You see? So now, pick up real quick Romans 5 and 12 for me, please.
Romans 5 and 12.
What's up? Right here, he's swapping. We're going to push. 11 goes here. 13 actually goes here. I'm going to put plate 11 right in the midst here. Alright. Now the first speaker already brought out, you see, how the man came in. Alright? Mm-hmm. You see? Let's read, please. Romans 5 and 12. Now this is the Apostle Paul in the present kingdom age.
Wherefore?
Hold it, please. Apostle Paul is in the present kingdom age. And he's looking back at this event right here. That's what he's doing. He's looking back. You see? And he's showing you what happened in the garden. All right? Let's read now.
Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin.
Now, that man is Adam, who came in on the sixth day. You see? And listen, he was made spirit, soul, and body. All right? As he's coming in. And Yahweh formed Adam from the dust of the earth. Because dust is a type of pure spirit. It has no particular or descriptive shape or form. Inscrutable, incomprehensible, and indiscernible. So he formed him from the dust of the earth. The finer particles of the earth, if you will. Let's read, please.
And so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned.
Now listen, when he formed Adam, made him spirit, soul, and body from the dust of the earth. And then when he took up residence, I'm talking about when Yahweh Elohim took up residence in Adam, the book says he became a living soul. You can read that over there in Genesis, I believe that's 2 and 4. All right? I think in the Holy King James Version it's 2 and 7. He became a living soul. Adam did not become a living man. He became a living soul. Alright? In other words, these attributes took up residence in him. Alright? And then Yahweh placed him in the garden. In other words, Adam was formed outside the garden, but he was placed in the garden.
That's right.
Alright? It's just like you take on shape and form in your mother's womb, and then you're placed in the earth. Alright? I'll see it that way. Alright? Let's read, please.
13. For until the law, sin was in the world. But sin is not imputed.
Hold it right there for me, please. Now look. When Adam gets in, alright, all the animals already in place. Alright? All the animals that was on the earth was already in place. In other words, he had nothing to do with the creation of the origin of these animals. Nevertheless, Adam himself, he was Yahweh made manifest. And I know it says in the Bible that he was a figure. And there's an argument about that. But Adam, he was no type. Nevertheless, he could not, how can I say it? Adam could not get on that cross, yet he did. I'm not sure if that makes any sense. In other words, this was Yahweh made manifest, instituting and setting up how Yahshua Messiah is going to get up on that cross and lay down his life for us and usher in grace or the New Testament or the New Covenant. You see, but we did not know who Adam was. We look at Adam as Adam like one of us. We had no idea that Adam was Yahweh made manifest.
Right.
You see, and he was in fact the first Adam, and the founder told us and made us understand how the Yahshua Messiah, he was the second Adam, if you will. Nevertheless, he brings the man in. Matter of fact, let me just get back a little further. Pick up 1 and 26. Genesis.
Genesis 1 and 26.
Come on, please.
And Elohim said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, mm-hmm. and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the fowl of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth.
Come on, read, please.
So Elohim created man in his own image.
Mm-hmm.
In the image of El created he him. Male and female created he them. And Elohim blessed them, and Elohim said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth,
mm-hmm.
and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the fowl of the air, and over every living thing that moveth upon the earth.
In other words, there is an animal kingdom, there is also a plant kingdom. But if there is kingdoms, there's got to be a king in every kingdom. Is that right? Adam was king and high priest in that kingdom. In other words, he was given dominion over the animal kingdom and the plant kingdom. Alright? Male and female. You see? He said, created they them. Right? Now, what you don't read where it says, and called their name Adam. Is that up in there yet? Pick up the fifth chapter of Genesis and read just the first verse or two. And you stay where you are.
Genesis 5. This is the book of the generations of Adam in the day
mm-hmm.
that Elohim created man in the likeness of Elohim made he him. male and female created he them and blessed them and called their name Adam.
So she was Adam as well. So here, we got, you get back where we left off at, you got Adam coming in. You see, Yahweh puts the man in a deep sleep. You see, the woman is encouraged or immersed in Adam. You see, then Yahweh draws the woman out. You see, and as the sun is coming up, he presents his woman, you see, I mean, present to Adam his bride. Or he presents the woman to the man Adam, or Yahweh presents his bride to him. All right? And then you see him up here in perfect peace and in perfect harmony. And you see that old bad boy back there in the background. That is not Yahshua Messiah. That is Lucifer himself waiting. In other words, that's him way back here. You see, that boy right there. You see, and what he's doing, he's waiting to draw you into darkness, just like he drew the woman Eve into darkness. You see, but that did not happen at this particular time. At this particular time, that when Moses was seeing the woman drawn out, and he's seeing him in perfect peace, he had left the Israelites down here in the land of Egypt, you see, and they're waiting for him to come down out of this mountain right here. You see, and they was waiting for him to come down out of his mountain. What are you going to say? And what he saw, they had no idea. But they know he was going up to get the table of stone, because Yahweh called him up to get the table of stones. But when he gets down, you see, he sees them have built a golden calf. Now, prior to that, you see, when Moses is left like this, see them in perfect peace, as the founder says, they were in love, you see. But see, this boy right here, Lucifer, he is there lurking in the back. You see, and he is fast spying out his father's nakedness. What do you mean his father's nakedness? It was Yahweh who created Lucifer. You see, and he created him to oppose and to deceive. That was his mission and that was his goal. So he's back there looking at him, spying out these two. You see, now look, they're already brought out that when he cast them down to earth, he cast them out to the unfinished creation or to ethereal darkness. And at this particular time, Lucifer, he did not have a body. Only thing Lucifer is an angel with the carnal mind. But in order for him to operate, he needs a body to operate in. And at this particular time, he didn't see it. You see, he didn't have a body. And the founder said it like this. The light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. The one that was dark, you see, was Lucifer. He was cast into ethereal darkness, as is written right here. Immersed in ethereal darkness. And this right here is showing forth he is immersed in the earth. And you got him being, making a descent or being cast out of the mountain. You got Lucifer leading him, you see, and those angels that followed him out, you see, made up his body. But when they get down here, they're out here in ethereal darkness, you see, and the only thing they need or waiting for is a body. Now when he formed the man Adam, made him spirit, soul, and body. And then when he draws the woman out and presents Adam, his bride, and they are in perfect peace, he didn't bother Adam when he was in the garden. But as soon as he sees the woman, here he comes.
Right.
Now the question is, why did he go to the woman? Genesis, I think I want 10 and I think 8. Nimrod. All right, that's what I'm looking for.
Genesis 10:8.
Yeah, now listen. Some folks ain't gonna like it if I'm saying it anyway. Mm-hmm. See, we always point to Lucifer as this angel. Mm-hmm. The problem is that you never see him in you. Mm-hmm. You see? And so it's like, oh, you know, am I Lucifer? I'm not calling you a devil. Mm-hmm. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying his job and his mission is right. To keep you looking at the flesh. And the flesh that he had her looking at was the tree. Mm-hmm. You see, right now we got us looking at each other, at ourselves nowadays. Mm-hmm. You know, we got to get our hair done. I shave my hair because I don't like the gray. Arrogant. That's vanity.
Right.
Simple, just so simple. I dye my hair because I don't like the gray. Vanity. I thought I'd put it on me because I know y'all don't do this kind of stuff. You know what I mean? I spray on cologne because I like smelling good. Vanity. I wear deodorant because I don't want nobody to smell me, because I don't like smelling myself. All right? Vanity. You see? That's the reality. And that's what he has done to all of us. I just put that on me because you already know what you do. Whatever it is, in the secret and darkness, the fact that you know, Yahweh knows.
That's right.
That's what I'm trying to say. But it's vanity. Never, and that's all it is. Because when Yahweh drew the woman out of the man, she, listen, was subject to vanity. All right? Let's prove that. Romans 8 and 20. All right? Let's go.
Romans 8 and 20.
Read on. I'm going slow today.
For the creature was made subject to vanity.
The creature was made subject to vanity. That's us. Mm-hmm. In this case, it's Eve. Remember, Eve was the mother of all living. And Adam was the father of all living. All right? Read on.
Not willingly.
Not willingly? You know how kids say, well, I didn't ask to be here. Sit up! Well, you go this, go this, go do that, go do that. Hold your... I didn't ask to be here. I didn't ask for nothing like you anyway. I'm talking about me. Uh-huh. Oh, these kids get all smart with you and everything. Because uh-huh. they get grown, because they got tired of all how you treat them when they was little. They didn't have this, didn't have... That's vanity! Mm-hmm. It's vanity and it's flesh. Mm-hmm. That's all it is. And listen, everybody goes through it. Mm-hmm. You see? Or, you know, some parents are crazy. You get the mumbling on your breath, what you say? And then you lie and say nothing. Mm-hmm. You know, you said, you know, you know that scene in the Bible where, in Matthew, we ain't gonna go through it, where the priests, help me out here, the priests were, they had challenged Joshua. Matter of fact, I can't remember, let's pick it up, it's Matthew, I think it's the fifth chapter, where he's talking about, even if you just look at a woman, you see, then you committed adultery. Yeah. Because they thought that if they didn't do the physical act,
right,
the priest, they thought that they were safe and it was okay. We still kept the law. And he said, even if you think it, you did it. And that was condemned them in their conscience.
Right.
Because it is Yahweh who is sitting on your throne at all times. Not him, but it's Yahweh himself that is sitting in your throne. This is just the veil. Yahweh gave Lucifer permission to be on the veil. And if you look on plate 4, we ain't going to get to it. On day 4, there's a veil up there, and you see Saturn is on the veil. And Saturn is a type of satanic spirit. In your consciousness, that sixth departmental veil, or that second departmental veil is the sixth step in your tabernacle. That is where Lucifer keeps you from seeing who is sitting on the throne, which is Yahweh. You see, and what we say, well, the devil made me do it. The devil ain't made you do nothing. You see, or Yahweh ain't made you do nothing. It was your own flesh. What you think, what you feel, what you believe has made you do what you do. Whether you lie, cheat, or steal, it's all the same. The point is, you did it. You know how we do it. You know. Did you do this? Well, so-and-so, I didn't ask you about so-and-so. I asked you, did you do it? And you're on your job, folks say stuff like this. Well, you let so-and-so do so-and-so. Say, well, I ain't talking to so-and-so right now. I'm talking to you. You're a target. I'm trying to figure out why you are so-and-so. You target. But it's you. But you want to blame there. You want to point the finger, everybody get the focus off you. All that is a satanic trick, and that's all it is. Now, but read, vanity. Come on.
About vanity.
Yeah.
Matthew 5:28.
We're going to pick up Matthew, but we're going to get Romans as well.
Okay. Matthew 5:28. But I say unto you, that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart.
Now back up a little bit to pick up the thought.
27. Ye have heard it said that by them of old time, mm-hmm. thou shalt not commit adultery.
Right.
But I say unto you, that whosoever looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery already with her in his heart.
So therefore, you can be standing next to your wife, and you're reckless eyeballing. You follow what I'm saying? Y'all know what I'm talking about, right? But you ain't done nothing. But the fact that you thought it, you did it. That's what he's saying.
That's right.
You know, that's all. And I just want to draw that out to show forth a spiritual principle, but that's a manifestation of him. You see, that's all I'm saying. Now let's hit back.
Romans 8 and 20.
Read.
For the creature was made subject to vanity.
The creature was made subject to vanity. That is the woman. Read, please.
Not willingly.
Not because she wants to. That's why we're here. Because we're the bride. We didn't ask to be here. Read on.
But by reason of him who had subjected the same in hope.
But it was Yahweh that got us here. And once we got here, we want to live the good life. In other words, everything we learned from the day that we were born, the thing we learned from our parents, the thing we learned from our teachers, our friends, our neighbors, our priests, whatever we learn, you follow what I'm saying? It's going to make up this matrix, this composite. You see, this amalgamation or agglomeration of a coring mass that you are. You're just going to take on the ways of the world, just like Moses took on the ways of the world. You see, nevertheless, you're still a son of Yahweh. The problem is, you don't know it. Moses was still a Hebrew, you see, but he didn't realize how much of a Hebrew he was. He was told and taught that he was a Hebrew because his mother raised him as a child when she nursed him. But had that not been so, he would have thought that he was Egyptian just like everybody else. However, when the world looked at Moses, he was wearing Egyptian clothes, you see, and they thought that he was an Egyptian. Nevertheless, he spoke Egyptian, but he also spoke Hebrew, all right? And so when people look at you, like, y'all heard of Suge Knight, right?
Mm-hmm.
I think everybody him. Now listen, I have a patient who lived right next door to Suge Knight. And this is what he said. He was not raised that way.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I'm saying. But he acted like he's a gangster.
Mm-hmm.
In his 40s, 50s, whatever it is.
Mm-hmm.
What they call the so-called OG.
OG.
You see, don't make sense for somebody to be 40, 50 years old talking about he's a gangster.
Gangster.
That's ridiculous. I mean, at some time you should grow up.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, let's face it. See, I don't like changing diapers. Hate it with a passion. I don't even like wiping my own butt. I just have to.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think anybody else has a joy in that. But the point I'm trying to say, the reason I do it because I have to, but I expect at some point in time you grow up and wipe your own butt.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's why I don't have animals, because I don't want to clean up nobody's. You understand? That's why I don't have animals, for the very reason. But the point is, you got to grow up and do something. I would think if you grow up, you know, being gangbanging as a kid, but gangbanging in your 40s, and your 50s, and your 60s, that's just outright ridiculous. That means you were just caught up in that darkness, and you cannot grow out of it. You're just steeped in stupidity and ignorance, because it's about you, and it's never about anybody else. You see, talk about the damn transgression. Let's read, please.
21, because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into
Read.
The glorious liberty of the children of Yahweh.
So the creature has to be delivered. But what I want to show you how she thought, just she had a rite of passage through Lucifer, because his goal was to lure her into darkness. Now this is why he went to her. Genesis 10 and 8, 11 and 8. I think that's what, 10 or 8, I think it's 10 and 8.
Genesis 10 and 8.
Mm-hmm.
And Cush begat Nimrod.
Yes.
He began to be a mighty one in the earth.
Now, Nimrod was the one that built the Tower of Babel.
Right.
And so Yahweh said, what? I will never destroy the earth by water again. So Nimrod, same devil, did the same thing to the people as he did to Eve. He told her that in the day that you die, if you partake of the fruit, you will not die. Yahweh said, in the day you take of the fruit, you will surely die. He said, no death will you die. So he took something physical to pervert something spiritual in her consciousness. So in that, Yahweh already set up and told Noah he'd never destroy the earth by water again. Guess what? Here come Nimrod. Just in case Yahweh lied to us and he don't keep his agreement, we're going to build us a tower that's going to extend way into the heavens. That way the water can't affect us. That's what he did. He's opposing Yahweh again. But he's talking to the bride of Yahweh, which is the people. Let's read, please.
He was a mighty hunter
before
Yahweh.
Read on.
Before it was said, even as Nimrod the mighty hunter before Yahweh.
Read on.
And the beginning of his kingdom was Babel and Erech and Akkad and Calneh.
That's
and
good
the man
right
Shinar.
There. Now, what does a hunter do? Now, Nimrod was, he used to hunt animals, bears, lions. No, he protected people. He was a mighty hunter. So what does a hunter do? He lie in wait, and he watch his prey. That's his goal. That's his mystery. And what he does, when he shoot that deer or that buck or whatever, he makes sure he looks good. He blends in with the
environment.
Yes, the plants, whatever. And they don't see him, and they talk like this. Y'all seen TV? Mm-hmm. They be whispering and all that kind of stuff. They be whispering when they talk to each other, when they hunt together, because they don't want to, because their ears are very keen. And they lie in wait, and boom, next thing you know, they got some food to eat that night. You see, well, that's what, what you call those guys? Help me out here. Someone, a stalker. That's what a stalker does. He may look at you, he likes you, or she, and they're watching every move you make,
right.
Watching you know what time you go to the store, what time you get in your car, what time you leave home, what time you, they're stalking you. Well, that's exactly what he does. The problem is that your stalker walks with you 24/7. You know, wherever you go, he goes. My point is, he is nearby watching every move you make, and he can tell you everything you're going to do. And you know what? When you start speaking, you may say, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, I'm letting you know. He knows all about it. That's what he does. He watched every move you make. So therefore, he knew to go to the woman, because the woman does not know the purpose. Yahweh Elohim knows the purpose. And when Yahweh Elohim, listen, don't miss this, when Yahweh Elohim, you see, took on shape and form and took up residence in the man, that was Yahweh made manifest. He is a photostatic copy of Yahweh Elohim. Talk about the man Adam. But at this particular time, he lived in Adam. Talking about Yahweh Elohim, lived in Adam, and we all lived in Adam, each and every one of us. Before we all died in Adam, but we lived in him first. So now the Yahweh, the purpose is now on earth because Yahweh is made manifest, or now the purpose, you see, is being manifested in the man, or the kingdom is now on earth. It is Yahweh Elohim bringing his purpose down through the man. So if the purpose is coming down through the man, you see, you got to see the righteousness and the unrighteousness in the man, Adam, you see, being carried out through the flesh, if that makes any sense. Read, please.
Romans, I'm sorry, Genesis 10 and...
I'm through with Genesis. Okay. Go back to Romans.
Go back to Romans.
Mm-hmm.
10.
Okay. Romans 8 and...
Where we left off.
20. For the creature was made subject to vanity,
mm-hmm.
not willingly, but
read.
By reason of him who had subjected the same in hope.
Read.
Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption.
Now the creature, which is the woman, had to be delivered from the bondage of corruption. Read on.
Into the glorious liberty of the children of Elohim.
In other words, she had to be delivered, you see, into this house, which is Yahshua the Messiah, or the King of Yahshua. Read on, please.
For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves.
That's good enough right there. My point is, the woman is subject to vanity. We are subject to vanity. We're in the earth. We have to take on the way of the earth. And whatever culture you belong to, or whatever culture you've been birthed into, you may take on that culture. Mm-hmm. If you're into a culture where it is music, everybody in the house or everybody in the family plays some type of instrument, chances are you're going to play one too. You follow me? If they gangsters, chances are you might be one too. You see, if they're in politics, chances are you may be one too. And if they're in the movies, usually the family, the offspring of those stars, they get involved in that culture as well. You get my point?
Mm-hmm.
All right? So, whatever culture you're growing in or you've been brewed in, you see, more likely that's where you want to be, or you don't want to be a part of that, and then you take on another part of the world. You may look at his life and say, I want to be like Mike. You see, I want to be like Tiger Woods. I want to be like so-and-so. Well, all this be like, you see. See, Lucifer says, I will be like the Most High.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he says. In other words, he cannot be Yahweh because Yahweh says, I will be what I will to be. Lucifer can only be Lucifer, and that's it. He cannot be what he want to be. However, he does have the ability to transform into an angel of light. Give you the appearance that he's being good, you see, and that he likes you and he cares about you. But in reality, the goal is to get you into that darkness. Example, these gangsters, they take young kids, 12, 13, 14, and 15, and they become their parents. You say, you mad at your parents? I'll kill your daddy. I mean, there's somebody, that was a testimony in our class. I'll kill your father. He said, man, don't kill my father. He said, but if he gets in the way, I'll take him out. That, I'm your daddy. And whatever I say, that's what you do. Because that's the power that this boy has. And listen, nowadays, and Dr. Samuel can attest to this, in Mexico, these cartels, they take these young kids, 12, 13, 14, and they bring them into the gangs or into the cartel. They'll give them $1,000. $1,000 is a whole lot of money in Mexico. Am I right or am I wrong? Yeah, you see, and they'll say, go kill so-and-so, and they go do it. And then they become assassins, you know.
Right.
Growing up, you see, because they're part of the system now, you see. But they don't know Yahweh. They've been drawn into darkness, and they think because they have money, wealth, nice clothes, nice car, nice home, all that, they think that they're living the good life. Have no idea that they are in the midst of hell. And that's all it is. It's just appearance of light. But in reality, the way thereof is death. In other words, they are reality dead men walking. That's all they are. You see, I'm talking about people who think they have life through wealth or through the flesh. So therefore, here come Yahweh bringing Adam in. You see, and his goal is to bring the purpose down through the flesh. Head back to Genesis, because I got to get out of here. Start at, real quick, Genesis 3 and 1, and then we head down. Because we already brought the woman in, you see. And when we brought the woman in, remember, Yahweh told Moses to go back down here into the land of Egypt, you see. And to bring down the table stone and place them in the Ark of the Covenant. Because remember, the first 7 days, 6 days, he saw the creation, and then he sees Yahweh enter to his rest, talking about Moses. And then for 33 days, Moses sees divine specifications on how to build and construct that tabernacle. I think that would, is that up there someplace? Oh, what is that? I know it's somewhere up here. I don't need it. What plate is that on? I just tell me, no, not the tab. What plate is that one over there, the number of it?
Three?
Is that plate?
Three?
In other words, what's that number of that plate?
Which one? This one right here.
Yeah, what's the number of that plate?
It's three.
Plate three?
Yeah.
That's not what I want. My point was, there's a tabernacle up there someplace on the 40 plate chart. In other words.
You're talking about this one over here.
Well, you have it. It's 13.
It's 13. 13. Then what I'm talking about is here then. In other words, he comes back down out of the mountain with the tabernacle in his consciousness. Mm-hmm. And as he's coming back down, he sees the transgression. And when he sees the transgression, at this particular time, the tabernacle is not yet built. He builds that golden calf. He saw the golden calf had been built, you see. And what Moses did, he waxed hot and breaks the table of stones. You see, now it was necessary for Moses to come back up into that mount, you see. And then when he goes back up into the mount, this time he has no idea what he's going to see. Not only does he see the 7 days of creation again, but now he sees the transgression. And when he sees the transgression, now he is seeing how that Lucifer is going to come into that garden and drive the man out of the garden. And that's what we're reading about right now. Let's read.
Genesis 3 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, which Yahweh Elohim had made.
Mm-hmm.
And he said unto the woman.
Now here is the serpent. Now we have a serpent painted on the tree. To show you that it was about the tree. It was only two people in the garden, Adam and Eve. This white figure right here is showing forth that there's a vision taking place. But he is not a physical manifestation in the garden as it has been taught. But this is a vision that is taking place. You would never see Lucifer if it was not painted on a chart. Just like you would never see your transgression if it wasn't pointed out to you. But anyway, let's move on.
Yea, have Yahweh said,
read,
ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden.
Read on.
And the woman said unto the serpent, mm-hmm. we may eat of the fruit of the trees.
Now
of the
garden. She's looking at the tree. You see, and Adam, good picture of it, he's over here sitting over there watching her. All right? And as he's sitting there watching her, you see, she's watching her look at the tree. Read on, please.
But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, Elohim hath said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest you die.
So that's what she was told. Now Adam is over here minding his own business, and he ain't touched no tree, didn't think twice about touching the tree. But her, as she passed by the tree, she looked at the tree. Mm-hmm. You see? So that's how Nimrod, or Lucifer, knew to go to her. Because she was the weak one. And she was subject to vanity. You see? Read on.
And the serpent said unto the woman.
Not the snake, but Lucifer behaving like a snake. The characteristics of a reptile. Read on, please.
Ye shall not surely die.
He said, you ain't gonna die. Come on, girl. Go ahead and eat that tree. Ain't nothing gonna happen to you. Read.
For Elohim doth
not. Now hold it. It says Elohim. Adam doth say, because Adam is Yahweh Elohim, or Yahweh made manifest. And at that particular time, her name was Eve, and she was Elohim too. Contrary to what anybody may tell you. She was Elohim just like he was Elohim. How do I know that? Wisdom was a part of her makeup. And he's going to tell her that if you partake of the tree, you're going to become wise as Elohim. Well, wisdom is part of her makeup. She was already Elohim because she was already Adam. Let's read.
For Elohim doth know, in the day ye eat thereof,
read.
Then your eyes shall be opened.
Read.
And ye shall be as Elohim.
Well, she was already that. You see? Read.
Knowing good and evil.
She going to go with no good. Look, only Yahweh Elohim knows both good and evil. Because it was him who created both good and evil. Okay? And put it out there. And let me say this. Lucifer is a asset, but he is not a liability.
Right.
That's what the founder said. We have light here, but in order for this light to work, we have to have a negative wire, correct? Yeah. To get the light. You see, in order for us to have in our heart, we have veins and arteries. We have arterial blood, which is the red blood. We have deoxygenated blood, which is the venous blood. But you have arteries and veins. You got to have the two in order to function.
Right.
One is deprived of oxygen, which is deoxygenated. The other one have lots of oxygen that feeds all your body. But you have to have two, and they work in harmony. You follow what I'm saying? So you have to have the negative and the positive in order to get a positive. You see, I mean, in this respect, in order to grow, it has to, in other words, in order for this light to come on, you have to have a negative and a positive for you to appreciate it. Likewise, your car has a negative wire and a positive wire in order for it to start. You need them both. You can't have two negative wires to start that car, nor two positive wires to start the car. It has to have a balance or an equilibrium, you see. Likewise, Yahweh brought this boy in, Lucifer, to oppose him. You see, talking about himself. He created his own adversary, which is Lucifer. But nevertheless, here's Lucifer in the garden opposing what Adam said or what Elohim said. Let's read.
And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food,
she looked at it,
and that it was pleasant to the eyes,
it appealed to her,
and the tree to be desired,
she wanted it,
to make one wise,
read,
she took the fruit thereof and did eat.
Now, when she ate the fruit, she didn't get wise. She just knew what it tastes like. It tastes like a variation of maybe another fruit. It's just like at the coffee place. You know, you got mocha mix, you got frappuccino, and you get my point. You got different kind of coffee. You got deep. It's a variation of the original. But here she is partaking of the fruit. But all the fruit trees in the garden. Come on, there was grapes. There's all the berries: blackberries, blueberries, radberries. You follow me? You got bananas, oranges. You got all kind of fruit. But you also got an olive, which is also a fruit. And the properties of a fruit is basically a seed, the meat, and the skin. I don't care what it is. You can make a lot of money off this too. You ask somebody, is an avocado a fruit or vegetable? Most people are going to say it's going to be a vegetable because it ain't sweet. But it has a seed, it has meat, and it has skin. It's a fruit. Cucumbers is a fruit. It has meat, it has seeds, and it has a skin. But it's used as a vegetable. Tomatoes is a fruit. It has seeds, it has skins, and it has meat. But it's used as a fruit. You see? Lemons is fruit. It ain't sweet, but people know it's a fruit, but it's sour. You see, but it has seeds, it has meat, it has skin. Those are the property of a fruit. You see, witnessing to the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Nevertheless, an olive have meat, you see, and it has skin, and it has a seed in the middle. That's what it was, all right? Let's read on.
And gave also unto her husband.
She gave it to him. Now listen, we got a pattern. Remember, hear that. You see, here's our most holy place. Yahweh is in the midst, sitting on the throne, right? And if you come on down here, you're going to see here Adam is sitting on the earth plane. The fruit trees point to the angels that are on the veil. You see, because the plants are like the type of the angelic host. So you got all these angels embroidered on the veil. You got Adam sitting between two trees, you see, looking at this event taking place. All right, read on, please.
Her husband with her, and he did eat.
Read on.
And now, the eyes of them both were open.
Now, when he ate, the book says their eyes were open. When she ate, nothing happened. Yeah. Now, when he ate, you see, there has to be a change. That change is your second departmental veil that's taking place. In other words, Adam instantaneously died and is conscious. He was still Yahweh, but he also had a condemned mind at that particular time. As it was brought out, he was being obedient to be disobedient. Nevertheless, here come your second departmental veil. There's a change that takes place. All right? Read on, please.
And they knew they were naked.
They knew they were naked. Read on.
And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons.
Read on.
8. And they heard the voice of Yahweh Elohim walking in the garden in the cool of the day.
Read on.
And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of Yahweh Elohim amongst the trees of the garden.
Read.
And Yahweh Elohim called unto Adam and said unto him.
Now hold it. Yahweh talks to Adam. See, he's the mediator in the garden. He's the one that's telling Eve what to do and what not to do, but it was Yahweh telling him what to do. You with me so far? Let's read on. So that's the innocent. That is your golden altar of incense. All right? Let's read, please.
Where art thou?
Read on.
And he said, I heard thy voice in the garden, and I was afraid.
Read on.
Because I was naked.
So there is a conversation between Yahweh and the man. All right? Let's read.
And he said, who told thee that thou was naked?
Read on.
Hast thou eaten of the tree whereof I commanded thee?
So now the change took place. Read on.
I commanded thee that thou should not eat. And the man said, the woman thou gavest to be.
So he points the finger to her. Alright? So now Yahweh did pass judgment on the man as of yet. He goes and talks to the woman. Read, please.
She gave me of the tree, and I did eat.
So now he blames her. She said, go ahead.
And Yahweh Elohim said unto the woman,
read.
What is this that thou hast done?
Read.
And the woman said,
so she ain't stupid either. Read on.
The serpent beguiled
me. He did it to me.
And
read.
I did eat.
Read on. So she said she was tricked. For she deceived. You know what makes you so mad with people? My word is my bond. Mm-hmm. This is what they say. Mm-hmm. I need $100. I'll pay you next week. Alright? Mm-hmm. You see, I'm going to pay you next Tuesday, Daddy. You follow me? Then guess what? Tuesday come, ain't said one word. Now, one thing we say, man, got it right now. I'll get to you later. That's something else. Your word is still, you coming forward. But when you act like it don't exist, that's what ticks you off. I ain't said the word. I ain't even been as blunt as I want to be. That's what makes you upset.
Right.
You see? Or, you see, your partner says, I'm going to the mall. You with me so far? She been gone 3 hours, but she's next up. I ain't saying whatever. She could be playing cards over there. I ain't making no. But she's next door. And you go next day, I thought you were going to get them all. Now you want to know. Arguments. Well, you know, I saw so and so. She said, come, we're going to have a cup of coffee. The point, why you didn't call me and tell me you're making me think? So now you have a question mark in your head. You get my point? Mm-hmm. You see? And I'm letting you know, that's what upsets you is the deception, not the act. I don't care if you go in that door. I don't care if you go tomorrow. I don't care where you go. Long as you just let me know. And if you ain't gonna pay me back, cool. Just say I ain't got it right now. I'm cool with that.
That's right.
You get, but that's the deception. You see, read on, please.
And Yahweh Elohim said unto the woman,
read.
What is this thou hast done?
What have you done? Read on.
And the woman said, the serpent beguiled me, and I did eat.
So she blames it on him. Read on.
And Yahweh Elohim said unto the serpent, because thou hast done this, Thou art cursed above all cattle.
Read.
And above every beast of the field.
Come on.
Upon thy belly thou shalt go.
Mm-hmm.
And dust thou shalt eat all the days of thy life.
Now just like we got a serpent going coming on down from the tree. He's coming off the tree. Now he's on the ground. You see, now he's still on the ground, coming right on out of that garden. Now that red serpent is pointing to the man, showing that the man has a condemned conscience, you see, and he's coming on down. In other words, he's bringing that purpose on down. And when Adam partook of the fruit, let me say this. Adam had to take responsibility for his bride like he take responsibility for your kids. Your kids do something, they ain't got no business, guess what? They say, I'm going to go tell your mama or your daddy, whoever. And they expect them to take care of that, to address that issue. But the fact of the matter, Adam, she was his offspring. So he took responsibility for her. So when he took responsibility for her, guess what? Their eyes were open, and now y'all, we're going to drive them right on out of that garden. And you can see a big picture over here. There's a great big black ball right here. That black ball is symbolic that he was in darkness and his conscience. No more so, and I'm going to sit down in a second, because we're talking about the damn transgression. When Adam died in his consciousness, mm-hmm. we all died in his consciousness. Mm-hmm. Every last one of us. And what Christianity says is this, well, only had one law. I could have kept that law. Mm-hmm. No, you could not, because it was purpose for Adam to fall.
Right.
So you got to see Adam being upright, but you got also seeing him fall. So you got to see him in righteousness, but you got to also see him in unrighteousness. At the end of the day, Adam was being obedient to be obedient. He's bringing the purpose down. And when he partook of the olive, which has oil, that anointed him to operate in the flesh and to bring the purpose all the way down. And although we see that serpent right here, and we got this black ball painted right on the tail of the serpent, and it's coming right on down. Over that man's coming right on down in darkness all the way down. Setting up the city of Enoch, which came first, usually with Satan incarnating in him. And then here come Nimrod, setting up the Tower of Babel, you see. And guess what? Guess who's sitting at the top of that tower? Nimrod himself. And then you got the second Babylonian Empire, which is Nebuchadnezzar and his boys. Then you got the Medes and the Persians. In other words, that snake is coming all the way down. You see, the Medes and the Persians. You got the Greeks, Alexander the Great, and you got pagan Rome, which are the Caesars, and you got the papal Rome, which is still going on right now, the Catholic Church. My point is, you got that man, you see, sitting on the throne, because to this day, everybody knows this, the Pope is considered a representation of Jesus Christ until he gets back. Is that correct? So now what he says is gospel and it is law. So you got a man sitting up on the throne. You see, but the reality is, there is something in you that is hanging on your veil, not Yahweh. It's something keeping you from seeing, you see, the reality. Giving all praises to Caesar and giving all praises to the Roman Catholic Church, that is the deception. The reality is, the Caesars, you see, that's not Yahweh. The Rome, that is not Yahweh. It is Yahweh that set them up to carry out his purpose for you to see him. So it takes Yahshua Messiah, and I'm down, who is the rock, who is Yahshua Messiah. You see, that rock is Yahshua, to shatter this image. That's why we come here, to learn the death, burial, and resurrection of Yahshua Messiah, who is the rock. You see, and what he does, he teaches us and exposes who Satan is, who the adversary is, who Adam is, who we are, and why we act and behave the way that we do, so we can shatter that beast, you see, or shatter this man who is deceiving us through the flesh, through corruption, you see, by being nice or whatever the case may be. And when this rock or when the gospel is taught and exposes the adversary and he shatters that rock or shatters that beast, guess what? Now we come into the newness of life. So it says the kingdom of Satan abolished, the kingdom of Yahshua's Messiah restored. So if Yahshua's restored, he's going to be restored in you. And when that happens, now, and I'm down, when that happens, now the Spirit, or the Holy Spirit, is poured out in the hearts and minds of men, and now we're recipients of the gift of the Holy Spirit. First to the Jews, and 7 years later to the Gentiles. So the day of Pentecost, which is the day that the Holy Spirit was dispensed, and when you have that, that means all the mysteries have been unlocked, You see, all the covers have been taken off, and anything you want to know about your Creator, you can know that through Yahshua Messiah, because you're going to get out the way and you're going to become Him. And when you become Him, now the woman is clothed with the sun. Here's a better picture of it. The woman is now clothed with the sun. And the moon, which is ruled by the night or the darkness, you see, the sun dispels that darkness, you see, or the light dispels that dark, because Yahshua Messiah says, I am that light. And when He is that light in you, you see, then deception can have no more dominion over you. In other words, you're going to use that light to expose that darkness or dispel that darkness, because now you are Him, because you are now the bride of Yahweh, or the one of the bride clothed with the sun. You see, and the moon is on your feet, and that law have no more dominion over you, and that now, today, you can walk in the newness of life, and you are Yahweh made manifest in the personality of whoever you are. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Well, I truly thank the Father for allowing us to hold class this morning. We hold classes every Tuesday and Friday from 7:30 to 9:30. Sunday morning from 11 to 1. And the fourth Sunday of the month, we have a Spanish class from 9:30 in the morning to 10:45. So come back again and study with us. Bring your friends and all your enemies. And before the doxology, if you want a lecture of today's class, please see Kenway after class. And if anybody has any donations, I will accept them today. So come back again and study with us. Bring your friends and all your enemies and stand for the doxology.
I have an announcement. I'm going to be gone from the 1st to the 24th, so someone will keep the attendance. And I need a title and also only the speakers, and in what order, like first, second, and third.
Okay. Got you covered. Now unto Him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before the presence of His glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, through Yahshua the Messiah, our Sovereign, along glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all times, now and ever, let us all say,
Hallelujah.
Are you
good?
Practice.
Okay. Get that camera off me. Keep it on table.
Yeah. Oh, what, that broke?
Oh, are you?
Taylor, did you get the keys?
I did.
Taylor.
Yeah. Before,
yeah.